Okay, this video is called The Hermit Card in a Relationship Question. And I'm doing it because I read a blog post about how when you get the Hermit Card in a yes-no question about a relationship, this is a bad thing, apparently. But it's a good thing if you want to know how to improve your chances of finding true love. But in the video, I want to make the point, and what I'm going to be saying is that we should just answer the question the person has asked, right? And we, the reader, should adapt to the questioner and his or her needs and just deal with what they actually want to know. So to introduce this video, I think it's hard enough doing a reading without first having to get the questioner to ask a question that's different from what they wanted. You'll often read in blogs, for instance, about how it's important to ask the right question or to figure out what makes the question good or bad. Even if it's not what the questioner wants to ask, or even if it's going to give information that the questioner doesn't particularly want, right? So if I ask a question, the reader might want to discuss my unconscious fears, right, or something like that. I don't really care about my unconscious fears. I want what I want, whatever it is, and I want it right now, preferably, right? And I think that's the kind of situation that a lot of questioners are in, and that a lot of readers face. But people recommend that you change the question. And this can just make it more difficult to do the reading, because then the reader has to deal with the question, not just the question, but the questioner. Maybe the questioner's doubts, or maybe the questioner's annoyance about having to change what they want you to know, even if it's apparently for their own good, right? So I want to say we should just answer the question. And we don't have to get the questioner to change in order to make it easier for the reader. And I'm going to give you an example or two using the Hermit of how you can do this, even if you're just at the beginner stage. So I was thinking about the best way to introduce this. And let's say you go to an Italian restaurant and the waiter says, what do you want? And you say, I'll take a pizza with olives, mushroom, hot pepper and onion. And the waiter says, how about spaghetti with a nice green salad? I'll give you a good sauce with it and so on. And you think, maybe the waiter knows something that I don't know. So you say, okay. And then different people are going to have different reactions in that kind of situation. Some are going to be happy with the spaghetti, right? So they were okay. Some people will maybe wish they had stuck with the pizza, but that the spaghetti was okay. Other people are going to get really annoyed, you know, and all the time they're eating the spaghetti, they're wishing they had insisted on the pizza because that's what they really wanted. And maybe the thing, I should have said, bring me the pizza or the manager. It's your choice, right? So going along with somebody else's suggestion might work out, but it may not. So let's say you go for a tarot reading and the reader says, what do you want to know? And you say, okay, will I ever find true and lasting love? And the reader says, how about asking how you can improve your chances of finding true and lasting love? And you think, okay, that's what I'll do. In the same way that we can have difficulty in the restaurant, you may be happy with the reading, or you maybe wish you'd ask your real question. Or maybe you don't really listen to what you're being told because you're too busy thinking about the question that you were talked out of asking. Right, so the example that I'm going to give you, I read a while ago in a blog where there was an article about the importance of asking what the author said was the right question. So if you ask, will I find true love? The blog entry said, if you ask that and you get the Hermit, then this means that you're not going to find true love. You're going to be alone for your life and you feel disappointed by the reading. But according to the article, if you ask something like, what can I do to create a true love relationship? And you get the Hermit, same card, that's okay. Because all you need to do is spend some time alone and you're going to discover the inner resources that'll help you find true love. Right? So this is the kind of argument that bloggers or tarot people make. If you ask a yes or no question, then that's all you get, yes or no. But if you ask what they call open-ended questions, then you get an awful lot more that's going to set you on the road to creating your heart's desire. At least that's what they have you believe. However, I think tarot readers are better than this. I think tarot readers are adaptable. And because the reader knows more than the questioner, and you do as well, even if you're just a beginner, because you get some experience of cards and you've got your imagination. So I think you can see beyond the question and you're going to be able to make helpful suggestions. So even if the person says, will this happen, yes or no, you can make, if it's yes, you can make helpful suggestions or give explanation or suggest what more could be done to bring it about again, to bring about a good result again, or to bring about an even better result in the future. Or if the answer is no, you can help the person understand why not, or what they're doing wrong, or what they ought to change, or what they could change, or what they should do differently, so they don't get a repeat of the same no answer that they don't want. So let's say the question is an apparently bad one, right? It's a closed question. And somebody says, will I ever find true love? And you get the Hermit. So if the reader, not the question, if the reader has a very narrow view of life and you get the Hermit, you might say no, because it's the Hermit and the Hermit shows isolation. On the other hand, if you, the reader, have a broader view of life and you see something of life's possibilities, then you can look at the card, the Hermit, and you can trust that it's pointing out, or it's pointing to what should be brought into the conversation or discussed with the questioner. So I think in a way, rule number one is don't panic if you see an apparently bad card or an apparently bad situation shown by a card, but instead you trust the tarot and you think about what it can be showing. So you look at the Hermit card. And maybe you say, okay, a hermit is on his or her own. So this can be saying that you, the questioner, have a solitary streak, right? Which means that you need to be on your own for a bit from time to time. So the true love that you want has to be somebody who respects this and who's going to trust you if you want to go off on your own, or who doesn't get annoyed if you don't want to talk, or who can look after themselves for a while so you can have a bit of alone time. Right, so this is taking the Hermit card and the idea of isolation and solitariness and applying it in some way to the question. You're not expecting the card to give you a complete answer as if you were reading, you know, on the back of a book you get a paragraph that outlines the whole plot of the story. Right, that's not what you're looking for from a tarot card. But you take what the card shows you and you see an idea of that particular card as step one, or you use the idea as a starting point for an explanation for the benefit of the questioner. So with the Hermit, we've got the idea of separation from other people. But when you see the Hermit, you're not disheartened by the card and tell the person they're doomed to be on their own. The idea of separation or isolation is only step one. So the questioner has a solitary streak or is a solitary kind of person or needs or wants time alone or likes to do things on their own. So maybe the questioner is the type of person who likes to read books. Okay. And if you're reading a book, it's a solitary activity. It's not like being a member of a team where you've got to pay attention to what the other people are doing and you've got to follow along with a leader, or you've got to be ready to make a contribution if they call upon you. You're reading a book. So, and maybe you're reading and then you stop and you think, or you make some notes, or you underline the text, or you put the book down and follow a thought, or you pick up another book and to remind yourself of something. You probably don't want interruptions. And this can be what the Hermit card is pointing to. This isn't good or bad, right? Isolation and a question about relationships. It's not good, it's not bad, it's what's going on or what's to be discussed or what the questioner should be made aware of. So the reader doesn't jump to conclusions. But if you let the Hermit card give you ideas and just talk about what comes to mind, I mentioned isolation and a solitary streak, you can come up with something else. But if you just talk, you're trusting yourself and you're going to find that you automatically and without trying, you talk about what's important to the questioner. So you might look at the hermit and talk about a solitary streak. And then that can help the questioner to realize that there's nothing wrong with wanting to spend time alone occasionally, even though other people give them a hard time about it. Or you might look at the card and see the hermit on top of a mountain, or imagine that the hermit's on top of a mountain. So you talk about having to climb a mountain. So you set high goals and you figure out how to get them. So when it comes to the relationship, the hermit, what does it mean? You want somebody who plans, or who has a plan for the future, who sets goals and has a plan, or who likes to think ahead. And this may not seem that important to you, the reader, but some people don't like to plan and they get into trouble because they just drift along through life. And this is not the kind of person that the hermit wants or would be compatible with. And this can make the questioner take himself or herself seriously, because the people that the questioner knows might not appreciate or approve of this serious planning side of the questioner's personality. Or you might look at the card and talk about age, because the hermit looks older. So you talk about age and the wisdom that can come with age and experience. And so the questioner can realize that preferring or looking for an older partner isn't stupid, and it's not neurotic, as people can have been telling them. Because I think, why do people come for a tarot reading? And in a lot of cases, it's because they want a different take on the situation. Maybe they want a more truthful one. Or they can hear something different from the point of view that the friends and family have been telling them that has not been that helpful. So they're looking for helpful suggestions and possibilities. And I think that's what the tarot will give them. Okay, that's it for the moment. Thanks a lot.